Hello guys, welcome to the video. So we get a lot of requests from a lot of people saying they are very weak in permutation and combination. So after watching this video, I don't think you guys will be, you know, doubtful and you'd find PNC any more tough. So in this video, what I'll do is I'll just start covering with the basic concepts on PNC, which you must know, and then solve one, two questions on that particular concepts, and you know, meanwhile, I'll try so that you have an idea on all the type of questions which are asked in permutation and combination. And based on the response which I get on this video in the comments, I'll definitely upload one more video when in the level of the questions will be, you know, one level up. Here are basic questions, I mean not basic, the questions which will solve your concepts, basically questions which are related to your conceptual clearance. So we'll start with those, we'll try to cover each and every concept that you need to know for PNC for placements. And then one by one, we'll try to upload more videos depending on your response. So it totally depends on your response that we upload more videos on PNC in the coming time. So do not miss out on that. And apart from that, the best comments on this video will get, I mean, the top 10 best comments on this video will get any online class or materials they want to get from Prep and Stuff for free. So yes, do go after the video and comment on the videos. That could be anything, right? Your doubts or your explanation. I always appreciate people who come up with a better solution to my questions. If you have a better explanation to any question, you can definitely comment it down in the comment box and you will get a reward for that. So let's not waste any more time here. Let's start with what is PNC. All right, so a very basic question here. In how many ways can 8 students be seated in a row if 2 particular students always want to be together? So I'll explain a lot of theory here, but before that, just to start with a question, I've taken a question here. So here's a very basic question. So this falls into the first category of question wherein you will be given a case wherein any 2 particular things or 3 particular people or things like that, they always want to be together and you have to find out the combinations or the permutations related to that. So this is one very particular type and I'll tell you how we approach to such questions. So before that, let me give you some fair time to solve this question. So I'm giving you 45 seconds for this particular question and your timer starts now. Alright, so here's the question on your screen. In how many ways can 8 students be seated in a row if 2 particular students always want to be together? Alright guys, so before I start explaining the question, let me give you a very basic and brief on what is the difference between permutation and combination. A lot of people are confused with what is NPR and what is NCR. And NCR. Okay, so combination and permutation. The basic difference between, so this is for permutation. And here, this is for combination. So what is the basic difference between permutation and combination? The first important difference here is, combination is basically selecting R things out of N things, only the selection part of it, right? And what is permutation? Permutation is basically selecting R things out of N things and then arranging them. Basically, for example, let's say there are 4 students. And you need to select 2 out of them. right? So let's say there is a bench, right? Now, if it says, if the question says, in how many ways can you select two people? So the formula would be NCR. So that is a selection, only the selection, and you don't have to make them sit on a bench, table, desk, whatever, and you don't have to arrange them. It's simply selection. So selection is combination. So in that case, I'll use this formula NCR because it is for selection. So that would be 4C2. So what is NCR? NCR can be written as N factorial upon R factorial N minus R factorial. Yes. So 4C2 can be written as, so the, here basically I'm selecting two students out of four students. So that can be written as 4 factorial upon 2 factorial, that is R factorial, and again N minus R would be 4 minus 2. So that is again 2 factorial. So this is combination, basically selecting two students out of four students. What if the question says, in how many ways can you sit, make two students sit out of four students? I mean, that is basically selecting two students out of, let's say you have two chairs, right? These two chairs. And you have four students. So in how many ways you can make the students sit? So out of four, first thing is you have to select two students whom you want to make sit in the table, right? So that can be done using the same formula, 4C2. Yes. So that can be written as 4C2. I'm just selecting at the moment. So that is 4C2 is 4 factorial upon 2 factorial, 2 factorial. I have selected 2 now. What I need to do after this is I have to make them sit on this. So 2 students are selected. Let's say we have selected A and B. 4 students, let's say they were A, B, C, D. We selected A and B out of these cases. So the first case could be A is sitting here and B is sitting here. The second could be B is sitting here and A is sitting here. These are two different cases in which they can be seated. So this can be done in two different ways. How do we get that? So the first place can be filled in any of two ways. In the first set, out of AB, I can make anyone sit. So that can be done in two ways. Once one of A or B has seated on this position, there is only one seat left, one person left. So that can be done in one way. So 2 into 1 is basically 2 factorial. So the answer would be this multiplied by 2 factorial. Yes. Now, this 2 factorial and 2 factorial is gone. What we are left with is 4 factorial upon 2 factorial. Yes. So that is basically NPR. So NPR can be written as N factorial upon N minus R factorial, which is what we got from here. 4 factorial upon 4 minus 2 factorial, that is 2 factorial. So what we understood from here is permutation is nothing but combination times the arrangement. The arrangement of making them sit together, or if there are letters or anything like that. So arranging them in a position, left, right, first position, third position, second position. So permutation is basically both combination plus multiplied by the arrangement of the things. So basically permutation is NPR is nothing but NCR into R factorial. R factorial is basically arranging R different things. NCR is selecting R different things out of N different things. So that is the basic concept for NPR and NCR. Guys, I hope this was clear to you people, because if this basic things are not clear, it is going to be very tough for you to solve PNC questions. So if you are not yet clear, you can either rewatch this segment of the video once again to get the concepts clear, because I want you to know this fact before we start solving the questions. So the basic concepts are done. And if you still have doubts, you can definitely come in the comment section. Now, let me start solving this particular question for you. In how many ways can 8 students be seated in a row if 2 particular students always want to sit together? So, there are 8 students. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. 2 always want to be together. Make them a group. Done? So, this is one group now. Then, how many total different things you have now? Because I have made 2 of the students one single group. Because they always want to be together, so make them a group. So now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 things to be arranged. So that can be done in 7 factorial ways. Arranging 7 things in 7 things. The number of ways is 7 factorial. How we get that? So you have 7 people now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This group, I'm considering this as one single person for the time being because they always want to be together. This first position can be filled in 7 ways because everyone would be available to sit. So I can choose any out of those 7 in 7 different ways. So I have 7 options basically to fill this place. Once I have filled any one out of those 7, I'm left with 6. So this second position can be filled with any of those 6 people. Likewise, 5 for the third, then 4 and then 3 and then 2 and then 1. So that is nothing but 7 factorial. So how many ways 8 students can be seated in a row? 2 being always together, 7 factorial? No. Now, this part is done. Now, we have to think about the group as well. The group can internally also be arranged. For example, let me say the group was of A and B. Now, first case could be A sitting to the left of B. Second internal arrangement could be B sitting to the left of A. So basically, inside the group, you are arranging 2 persons. So that can be done in 2 factorial ways. Arranging 2 persons is 2 factorial. So the answer would be 7 factorial for the 7 different entities multiplied by 2 factorial for arranging the group. So this is your answer. The answer is 7 factorial into 2 factorial. So I hope you got this problem here. So this is the first set of problem which you get in placements, and a lot of placement questions you find this question. Number of ways when 2 are always sitting together. This could be 3 as well, right? If it's 3, let's say if it was 3, so you can make a group of 3 and then the internal arrangement would have been 3 factorial. Simple as that. So guys, this is the first type. Always, 2 are always together. Alright. Now, let us move to the next question. In how many ways 6 maths book, 5 science and 6 English books can be arranged so that the books of the same subject are always together? A similar question to the previous one. Yes? So take your time. I'm giving you 1 minute to solve this particular question, but I expect at least 50-60% of you to answer this correctly. So your timer starts now. Okay, the question says in how many ways 6 matchbook five science book and 6 English book can be arranged so that the same books of same subject are always together. 3 different sites, how do you approach to the question? So my approach would be, so the first thing is the subject wise books should always be together. The 6 matchbook will always be together, the 5 science books will always be together, and the 6 English books will always be together. So now we have 3 different groups. Basically, you have 3 different groups. You have a group of maths book, you have a group of science book, and you have a group of English book. 3 different sets, how can you arrange them? In 3 factorial ways? 3 different groups can be arranged in 3 factorial ways, right? Okay, that is done. Now, as per the previous question, what we did was we did the overall arrangement and then we entered into the group and we arranged inside the group which we created, right? So now let's move on to this first group. So in this first group, you have 6 matchbook. So this 6 matchbook can also be arranged internally. You have 6 different books. So you can either put one book. Let's say you have 6 different books of 6 classes, like class 1 to class 6. So you can internally arrange them, right? You can put from 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 1, 3, 5, 4, 6, whatever you feel like. So now in this first group, 6 books can be arranged internally in 6 factorial ways. 5 science books, right? So 5 science books can be internally arranged in 5 factorial ways. And 6 English books can be internally arranged in 6 factorial ways. So we first did the external arrangement of 3 sets of books, which is math, science, and English, and then came the internal arrangement. So we internally arranged them as well. So these are the total number of possible cases, nothing apart from this. Yes. So that's the answer to this problem. So that is 3 factorial into 6 factorial into 5 factorial into 6 factorial. Got the answer, guys? If not, definitely come back in the comment section. Give me an idea whether you guys are getting it or not. And we'll definitely try to teach it back when we take the next lecture, or maybe we'll try to solve your query in the comment section itself. All right. Let's move on to the next question. In how many ways can 10 papers be arranged so that the oldest and the newest papers never come together? So the first case was when 2 things or multiple things always come together. This is the case when things never come together. Oldest and the newest paper can never ever come together is the case. So this is the second type of question which you get in PNC in placements. So take your time, try to approach to this question. I'm giving you 1 minute for this particular question and your timer starts now. All right, so you have 10 papers, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. The question says the oldest and the newest paper can never come together. How do I approach to this question? See, for such particular question, there can be multiple ways. There can be ways which are deadly. I mean, they'll kill you. Trust me. So there is one single approach, the best approach to solve such questions. So the question says the oldest papers and the newest paper can never come together. What could be the cases? What would be the total number of cases? The total arrangements will be always together plus never together. These are the total cases. So, what are the total cases of arranging 10 papers? 10 factorial? Yes? This is how you arrange 10 papers. You arrange 10 papers in 10 factorial ways. You have to find out the number of ways when two particular papers never come together. So, what can we do is, total minus always together. Will give me the answer, which is never together. Yes. So, I know how to find the number of ways when the oldest and the newest papers are always together. Are you guys getting the point? So, finding out directly that two papers never come together, I cannot create the cases for that. There will be infinite number of cases and will definitely end up doing something wrong. What we'll do is we'll find the total number of ways of arranging 10 papers minus the cases when they are always together. That will give me the cases when they are never together. Total minus always is never. Yes. So these are the total number of ways to find when they are never together. So 10 factorial is the total number of ways wherein you can arrange 10 papers. Now, two particular papers, they need to be always together, right? We need to find those number of cases. So to find the number of ways wherein two are always together out of 10, we just did it in the first and the second question, right? So just pause the video, try to find out the answer here. That will give you a lot of confidence, right? So pause the video. Meanwhile, I'll start explaining. So always together, right? So two are always together. Sorted. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So arranging 9 different things is 9 factorial ways. Because this is, let's say, the oldest one, this is the newest one. We have made them one single group. So this one group plus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 plus 1 is 9. So we have 9 different things to be arranged that can be done in 9 factorial ways. And if you still remember the first question, this should be multiplied with 2 factorial. Why? We are arranging these two papers internally as well. Oldest and newest, this can be newest and oldest as well. The internal arrangement of those two papers. So that gave me 9 factorial into 2 factorial. So what are the total number of cases when the two papers are never ever together? That is 10 factorial minus 9 factorial into 2 factorial. Got it? All right. So we finally learned to find the number of ways when two things are always together, to find the number of ways when two things are never together, be it two things, three things, four things. You just have to create a group and you have to remember the internal arrangement of the group. Here, two things were grouping up. So 2 factorial, let's say you have 5 different things which needs always wants to be together. So in that case, it will be 5 factorial, the internal arrangement, and the rest, the external arrangement, is very easy. So things are sorted now. Now, coming to the problems with digits, forming numbers out of digits is another type of problems. And there are internally 2-3 type of problems which you mostly find in your placement. So here's the first question on your screen. How many 4-digit numbers can be formed using digits 1, 2, 3, 6, 8, and 9? You have to form 4-digit numbers of this 6 different digits given to you. You have to find the number of different numbers you can form using that. Take your time. I'm giving you 60 seconds to solve this question, and your timer starts now. Now, see, the entire lecture is totally a theory-based and passion-based lecture, right? So everything I have put up here is internally linked. So the first and the second and the third question which you did was about things wherein things were always together, never together. But there was one similarity in those three questions. What was that? That was, you have no selection thing there. You had exactly number of things and you have to just arrange them. There was no selection. It was only that arrangement part, right? What I said was NPR is NCR into R factorial, right? So we were just dealing with that R factorial. We never selected things because you had 10 papers, you had to arrange 10 papers. You had 8 persons, you have to arrange those 8 persons, right? It was not like you have to arrange 6 persons out of 8 persons, right? So that selection part was not there. Everyone was selected. You just have to arrange them. So that was one part. Now, in this question, the selection plus the arrangement both have come. Yes? So, you have to form 4 digits, 4 using 4 digit numbers using the digits 1, 2, 3, 6, 8, 9. So, the first case could be 6P4. Simply, you have to select 4 number digits out of this 6 digits and then arrange them. Yes? And things are sorted. Okay. But first thing here, the first issue here in this question is there is nothing mentioned about the repetition of the numbers. So let's just, you might be confused here. So let me just mention that you can repeat the digits. Yes, you can use the repeats again and again, right? So in that case, so the NPR thing, let's just ignore it for the time being because that might confuse you here. So let's just ignore it totally. So let me explain you in a different way, which is a better way always. You have 1, 2, 3, 6, 8 and 9. The question is, how many 4 digit numbers can be formed using the digits 1, 2, 3, 6, 8, 9, wherein the digits can be repeated, reused, right? So reused in the sense the first place, right? Coming to the first place always. The first place you can fill it in how many ways? You have 6 different digits. You can fill it in 6 different ways. Yes? Coming to the second position. Now, it says the digits can be reused or they can be repeated. So the second position can also be filled again in 6 different ways. Because you have everything available, right? Because you can reuse. Let's say you used 1 here, the digit 1 here, but it says the digits can be repeated. So in that case, the second position, you can also have again another 1, right? So basically you can form numbers like 1111 or 2222. You can repeat those. That case is possible here. So the third position can also be filled in 6 different ways out of 1, 2, 3, 6, 8, 9. Fourth also in this. So the answer is 6 raised to the power 4. This is the easiest case of forming 4 digit numbers because you can repeat all the digits. So there are 6 different digits. Every position can be filled in 6 different ways, right? The first can be 1, 2, 3, 6, 8, 9, any one of those. Again, the second can have any one of those. Third can have any one of those. And the fourth can also have any one of those. The next question we'll see when you don't have the right to repeat things, right? That is the actual scenario, right? That is a little tougher one. This is very easy. When you can repeat the digits, you can simply, you know, write 6666, right? You have 6 different digits. You have to create 4 digit number, right? So the 4 dashes are created, I wrote here, are for the 4 digits of a number, which is 4 digit number. The first digit can be filled in 6 ways, 1, 2, 3, 6, 8, 9, any one of those. The second can again be filled in 1, 2, 3, 6, 8, 9, any one of those digits can be selected again. Similarly for the third place, similarly for the fourth place, the answer is nothing but 6 into 6 into 6 into 6, that is 6 raised to the power 4, as simple as that. Alright, so if that is done, let's move on to the next question quickly, so that you don't forget what we taught. What we learned in the previous question. So here's another question, same question. The only add-on here is so that the digits cannot be repeated. So here's the rocket science. Not a rocket science, but a little difference between the previous question and this question. Here the digits cannot be repeated. Take your time, think on it, what difference it made when it you were able to repeat the digits and when you cannot repeat the digits. Think on that, take your time. I'm giving you 45 seconds and I'll get back to you after that. Okay guys, so I hope you guys are able to understand what I was trying to say from the concept wherein things can be repeated or cannot be repeated. So now here you have to form a 4-digit number similar to the previous question. You have the digits 1, 2, 5, 6, 8, 9. Now the thing here is the limitation here is the digits cannot be repeated. Yes. So the first position can be filled in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ways. Yes. Now, once you have filled in those 6 ways, to fill the third position, any one of this is done, right? Out of 6, you are left with only 5 now. 5 different basically. One, we don't know, right, which digit you filled here, but you filled it in 6 different ways. This is not the number 6, guys. This are the number of ways, to be clear, right? Do not confuse this with the digit 6. These are the 6 different ways in which you can fill this position. Now, out of this 6, one is gone here. And now, the thing is, the digits cannot be repeated, right? So, any one of the digits, if you have used it at this position, you cannot use it here. So, to fill this third position, you are now left with 5 different digits. 6 minus 1, 5 different digits. Similarly, for the fourth one, 2 are gone now, 1 for this position, 1 for this position. So now, to fill this particular position, you just have 6 minus 2, which are 4 different digits left to be filled. Similarly, 3 for this place. So the answer is 6 into 5 into 4 into 3. See, let's not waste a lot of time in calculating the answer. That you can easily do, right? The video is totally about understanding the concept and how you approach to different questions from P and C. Because I hope after watching this entire video, you guys would be able to solve any question related to P and C without any hesitation. And just the thing is, make yourself crystal clear in the concepts and be it any question, be it the toughest question, if your concepts are sound, you will never make any mistake. Because in PNC, it's not about practicing a lot of questions. It's about understanding the basics of the question. It's about understanding the basic concepts and then using the basic concept right? Whatever the question is, but if you use the concepts clearly and properly, there is no question which you will solve it wrong or, you know, you'll make mistakes in that. So, 6 into 5 into 4 into 3. Why? What is the difference between when the things are not repeated? Could be repeated. Nothing was getting used, right? Everything was available. Even after you used it, you had the option to repeat it. But here you don't have the option to repeat it. So 6 into 5 into 4 into 3. This can also be represented in this format. 6P4. Selecting 4 things, 4 digits out of 6 digits and then arranging them. So the formula would be 6 factorial upon 6 minus 4, that is 2 factorial. So that can be written as 6 into 5 into 4 into 3 upon 2 factorial can be written as, sorry, into 2 into 1 and 2 factorial can be written as 2 into 1. So 2 into 1 and 2 into 1 is gone. You're left with 6 into 5 into 4 into 3 which is your answer. But guys, I always suggest you to use this particular way to solve questions, cause this was an easy question, so you were able to put the direct formula and use it. But I want you to get accustomed to this particular trick, this way, so that whatever the problem is, whatever the scenario is, you are able to approach to that. Cause using the formula, there are certain limitations. You can use the formula into straightforward things, but wherein you have limitations or wherein you have to use another concept or another logic there, you will be stuck. So always use this trick. Now, maybe this video is a little slow, guys, cause I have to explain things again and again, cause I am also taking care of people who are totally ignorant about PNC, and whenever they see any question related to PNC, the best thing they do is they skip the question, and I want to help those people as well. So moving on to the next question. Okay, interesting question. How many 4-digit numbers can be formed using digits 0, 2, 5, 6, 8, 9 so that the digits cannot be repeated? Take your time. I'm giving you 30 seconds for this particular question, and I expect every one of you to get the correct answer this time. Okay, so your timer starts now. Alright guys, so how many of you say the answer would be the same as the previous question? Cause there are 6 different digits, you have to select 4 digits and create 4 digit numbers. So the answer would be 6 into 5 into 4 into 3, which is 6 5s are 30, 30 into 12 is 360. That's the answer or no? Or also, what do you guys say? 0, 2, 8, 9. Is this a 4-digit number? Or it's a 3-digit number? Chamka, right? A lot of people are like, yeah, I did this mistake. Yes? Okay, so pause the video again if you got the hint, and then try to calculate the answer again, and then I'll just explain it here for people who are still doubtful, right? So guys, the digits given here are 0, 2, 5, 6, 8, and 9. You have to form 4-digit numbers. Now, the concept of 4-digit number is this digit, the thousands place can never be 0, right? If the thousands place is 0, the number will be a 3-digit number, which is not what is asked in this question. You have to form 4-digit numbers. So the first position, in how many ways can you fill the first position? You have 6 different digits, but you cannot use the 0 here to fill this thousands place. So you have 5 ways to fill this position. Yes. Now, coming to the hundreds place, out of this 5 digits, 1 is gone here to fill the thousands place. You are left with 4 plus. Now you can use this 0 as well. Yes, because 0 can be here in the hundreds place. 2089 is a 4-digit number, right? 0289 is not a 4-digit number, but 2089 is a 4-digit number. So out of this 5 digits, 1 is gone here, so 4 left. For any 4 are left to be filled here, plus you also have a 0 as a choice. So out of this 5 again, so you have 5 ways to fill this position. 5, this would be 4, this would be 3. Yes, so the answer is 5 5s are 25, 25 4s are 100, 100 times 3 is 300. So this 60, 60 are the digits, numbers wherein 0 starts from the scratch. So you can also find out how you got this 60, right? You can just do one thing is you can fix this first position with a zero, right? And then this can be filled in 5 ways. This can be filled in 4 ways. This can be filled in 3 ways. So 5 4 3s, 5 4s are 20, 23s are 60. So there are 60 different ways where the first position is a zero. So 360 minus this 60. That can be also the way wherein you find out the answer, right? Total minus the digits wherein it is starting with zero. Total are 360. Then you fixate this zero here. Zero is fixated. So now this zero is gone from the case. You have 5 different digits you have to fill in 3 different places. First can be filled in 5 ways, second in 4, and the third in 3. So this total minus this particular case is 360 minus 60 will give you the answer as 300. Alright, so let me not waste time. So I'll try to, you know, pace up now in this lecture a bit, because you guys might have got a little bit of concept here. Now, the next question. How many 4-digit even numbers can be formed? Even numbers can be formed from the digits 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so that the number is even and digits not repeated. Right? So, tell me one thing. So, how many concepts did you learn from digits now? First one was digits can be repeated. Second was digits not repeated. Third one was to take care of things wherein you have a zero and you have to form 4-digit numbers, 3-digit number, whatever it is. The other case could be wherein the last position is even odd, right? That is one different case now. These are the different cases, right? Apart from that, the cases which you get, so there can be a case wherein they could ask you that all the even digits are always together, all the odd digits are always together. So that concept can be derived from the first, second, and the third question wherein I taught you when things are always together, not together. So that thing also can be combined to those questions, but these are the different unique concepts related to digits. If you know that, if you know this, you can combine them to get one single problem wherein, you know, I think you got my point. All right. So take your time. I'm giving you 30 seconds to this particular question. Your timer starts now. Okay guys, so the question says how many 4-digit even numbers can be formed using the digits 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So, to say a digit is even or odd, what do you see? You see the units place, right? If the units place is having an even number, the number is even. If the units place is having an odd number, the number is odd. So, out of this, which all are the even numbers? 2, 4, and 6. So you have 3 different even numbers. So it's obvious that this position can be filled in only 3 ways. Yes? So you can either put 2 here or 4 here or 6 here. So you have 3 different ways for this particular position. Now, sort. The question is sort now. So 2, 4 and 6. Out of this 3, any one is gone in filling this position. So to fill now after fixating this position, you can start in any ways from left to right or right to left. It's the same one and the same thing. So this position now can be filled in. Out of 2, 4 and 6, one is gone. So you have 5 left. After this 5, you will be left with 4 and then with 3. Yes? So the number of ways are 5 4s are 20, 20 into 9 is 180. 180 is the answer for this question. Yes? Okay, guys. Okay. let's move on to another question. So this question is basically the question for gaps. I just considered this to be falling into the segment called gaps. So you are done with now together things with when things are never together. You are done with arranging digits, all the different formats of it, the zero thing, the even positions and all those things. Now, this is a question of gaps, the number of gaps. I'll tell you how. Before that, just take your time. I'm giving you 1 minute for this particular question and your timer starts now. Okay guys, so the question says, in how many ways can 10 boys and 8 girls be arranged in a row if no two girls are together? So you have 10 boys, 8 girls, and the question is no two girls are together. What I'll do is, so just try to understand. Let me make this 10 boys sit. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. I made this 10 boys sit randomly. So in how many ways can you arrange 10 boys? 10 factorial ways. So here, there is no selection part, right? Because there are 10 boys, 8 girls, you have to make everyone sit. There is nothing mentioned like you have to make 5 boys and 3 girls out of 10 boys and 8 girls sit. There are 8 boys and 10 girls, you have to make everyone sit. What I did was, I made the 10 boys sit. Because for boys, there is no concept, right? They want to be together. So boys, they anyways fight less, I'm sorry. So they can sit the way they want, right? So, 8 girls, right? These 10 boys are now sit. We made them sit in 10 factorial ways. Now, if no two girls should be together, what we can do is, so, each boy, right? Every boy, if they are sitting, there is a gap in between them. There's a gap here as well, here as well, here as well. There are gaps. That is why I call it the question of gaps. So, if two girls are never together, in that case, what if we make the girls sit in the gap only? That is how these questions are approached. So you have to just make them sit in the gaps. If they are sitting in the gaps between the boys, so one gap, only one girl is sitting, right? In one gap, no two girls are sitting together. So in that case, the question will be wrong. Every gap, only one girl is sitting. In that case, that is the only case possible wherein no two girls are together. Because they are only sitting in between gap, which is created by two boys. So wherever any girl is sitting, left to her and right to her, there is always a boy, right? So that means no two girls will be together in that case. Yes. So 10 boys are sitting. So how many gaps are created? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 gaps are created. Yes. So you have now 11 gaps. You have 8 girls. How do you approach? How do you approach? So, 11C8.
Because I have 11 gaps, I have only 8 girls. So I have to select 8 gaps from 11 gaps. Because I don't need all of the 11, right? I need only 8. So how many number of ways can you do that? Selecting 8 gaps out of 11 gaps. 11C8. Yes. Now, you have selected 8 gaps. You have 8 girls, right? So this is the selection part. Now you have to arrange them. So 8 girls. You have 8 gaps for the 8 girls. Now, how many ways can you arrange them? 8 factorial ways. That's your answer. You can also write it as, so the options will be given according to the examiner, right? So the options can also be this way. 10 factorial into 11P8. Selecting 8 gaps out of 11 gaps and then making 8 girls sit there. So 11C8 into 8 factorial, right? This is also same as 11P8. So 11P8 is what is 11P8? Selecting 8 gaps of 8 gaps out of 11 gaps and then arranging them. That is 11P8. That's your answer. So the answer is this and this, both. Any one of these. Guys, that's all we have from the part 1 and the basics for permutation and combination, because everything cannot be covered in one single video and you guys also need some break. So let's just do one thing. Let's just sum it up here and we'll just simultaneously upload another video, which will be the part 2 or the continuation of this lecture, right? And that will be uploaded soon after this video, right? And the link for that can be found in the description of this particular video, so that you can, you know, continue your learning on permutation and combination. And that too will upload it depending on the response which we get from you guys on this particular video. Apart from that, guys, do not miss out on the giveaway round of from PrepInsta, which is basically the best comments get any online class or paid material of their choice for free, right? Apart from that, you can also join our Telegram group and our, you know, Telegram group, because we keep on updating a lot of things related to placements on our Telegram channel, the link to which can be found in the description of the video. So make sure you join that so that you're updated related to any placements happening in the country, right? So that's all, guys. So hope to see you in the second part of this video. Thank you.